you. You may be seated.
Good morning, church family. Oh, come on now. I know you're awake, especially if you were in Sabbath school. There's plenty of rousing discussion this morning. We can do better than that. Good morning and happy Sabbath, church family. I like that. A little more gusto. Okay. Got to make sure you guys are all awake, bright-eyed and bushy-tailed, so that we can worship the Lord together, right? This morning, I have a few announcements for you. Quite a few announcements. If you have your bulletin with you, you're going to see quite a few inserts. And again, I love that. That means signs of a healthy church, right? All kinds of fantastic ways to involve yourself, not only in the church, but get to know one another, be able to reach out to the community, invite your friends to some of these activities. So let's go through first, starting with some of our inserts. There is a Young Adult Vespers. And this Young Adult Vespers is not just limited to one church. This is area churches have young adults that are coming together, and each different church is hosting them. Now, that the coming week on the 3rd is going to be at Moxville Church at 6:30 on October 21st, excuse me. And it has the address here. All the information is listed here. So young adults, pay attention. This is your opportunity. Another fantastic event we have is a bonfire social. I mean, I love the season where it starts to cool down, the air gets a little bit crisp, and that's, you know, that fire that's roaring. Guys, this is gonna be wonderful. So the social committee is gonna be providing hot dog buns, Big Franks, drinks, all of this stuff. So bring your lawn chairs and put it on your calendar and your roasting sticks. Of course, who can have a bonfire without some roasting, right? All right, so that's on October 29th at 6 p.m. There is a baby shower for Jade Nemeth. Please make sure that you RSVP and let them know that you're going to be coming. That's October 23rd on the 2nd. And we also have on the same day, October 23rd, a little bit later in that day. If you want to get fit, Elena has got us toning and stretching. So this is another fantastic way. I keep telling my husband, we need to move more, honey. We need to move more, add more exercise into our lives, you know? All of that is part of keeping our body, presenting our body as the temple of the Holy Spirit, which is in us, right? So we want to keep ourselves healthy so that our minds can be healthy and fit. If you look in your actual bulletin here, we can see that Pastor is going to be going away on vacation this week. You're leaving us for a little bit, but he will be back next Sabbath. So just keep that in mind. I do have a couple other announcements, but I'm going to have different people come up and share some of those, and then I have a few more after that. Tracy, if you don't mind coming and sharing with us a little bit more about what our church is doing as far as prayer and how they can be involved in praying for one another, I appreciate that.
Happy Sabbath to everyone. I'm hard of hearing, so you're going to have to say that one more time to me. Happy Sabbath, everyone. All right. We are here. God has kept us another week, and we are very, very grateful. We're dealing with the church-wide prayer. There was a challenge that was brought to me. There are some people who are viewing us online, and they want to be a part of this church-wide prayer. But let me, before I go to them, those of you who are here, there are some of you who do not have a name. If you do not have a name that you're praying for, just raise your hand quickly if you do not have a name. Okay. Now, here it is. Some people drew a name, but they didn't put their name in. So we're going to solve that. If you did not put your name on the pink slip, you need to get it to me so I can get your name to someone. That's those that are here. Now we have people who are online, and they also want to be a part. So I'm talking to the communication team. Where's Julie? Where's Julie? Julie, where are you? Okay, Julie, yes. Julie was telling me that they're going to work it out where, I think in Facebook, is that correct? If you're viewing on Facebook, you could go ahead and submit your name, and then we can submit a name back to you. Is that correct? We can DM you a name that you will be praying for. So that's the way it's going. How many of you have been praying all week for your name? You have your name. Very good. Now, as I said, this is not a secret Santa thing where you don't have to share your name. I know who has my name. A young person has my name. Sarah has my name. We were talking about it at prayer meeting, so I'm excited. You can share who you're praying for. I want to search out. I started searching out the person's name that I have, and I'm sharing. I want to introduce myself to the person I'm praying to for, because she may know me, but I don't know her. So I want to get to know. So you can share. You can kind of share if you want. Let the person know that you're praying for them. Now, here it is. If you look in your bulletin, I put in the bulletin the scripture for the week. Each week, I want to give you a scripture that you pray over the person. And also, you can the Holy Spirit will guide you how to pray for that person. For this week, it is Psalm 51, verses, 10 and 11. Some of you may not have ever prayed scriptures before, and this is what you would do. That scripture says, create in me a clean heart. But what I want you to do, say if you're praying for me, Sarah, here you go. You would say, create in Tracy a clean heart and renew a right spirit in Tracy. Cast not your presence away from Tracy. That's how you would pray the scriptures over the person you're praying for. Does everyone understand? You do? Say amen if you understand.
Amen.
All right. And those of you who are online, you can do the same. Whatever platform, I'm going to talk to the communications team. We're going to figure out how we can exchange the names so you can be a part of our churchwide prayer. In advance, I want to thank everyone for joining with me in this. And I pray that God will begin. I pray not begin. Let me change that. That God will continue to move on our hearts and continue to move us in a direction where we all be safe to save. Wouldn't you like to get to heaven and see all of our church members there? So let's pray that we will remain faithful. We will continue to pray for one another as we march on toward Jesus and as we wait for Jesus to deliver us from this wicked world. So
Amen.
We say thank you. God bless you. Enjoy the Sabbath.
Thank you so much, Tracy, and thank you for heading that up. It's beautiful to know that there's somebody in this church family that is praying for you and you for them. The family that prays together and prayerfully goes to heaven together, right? Pastor has a brief announcement for us this morning as well.
Good morning, everybody. I just wanted to share with you the book that I'm hoping we're going to get started on in a few weeks for prayer meeting. It's Final Events. This is a very powerful book that takes you through all the events that we are going to be going through as we get closer to the second coming of Jesus. This is written by scholars and evangelists from around the world. It's an incredible book, and I'm looking into right now trying to see how we can get it in bulk so that we can have it available for you. But just remember, in about 3 weeks or so, we're hoping to get started with this Final Events. I think you'll really like it. So be praying that we can find them at the price that we can make sure everybody's able to get one. Thank you.
And if you have more questions about any of these things, remember that you can follow some of these events and things that are going on online via our social media, our website. The team is doing a beautiful job of keeping all of that at the forefront for us. So make sure that you check back in your bulletin or online for more announcements and more information. Now I'm going to take a moment just to welcome you all. And I want to just say I am so grateful that we are able to come together on Sabbath morning and see one another's faces and just to fellowship together. Let's not take that for granted. I just want to say welcome to all of you. Thank you for coming for Kernersville Seventh-day Adventist Church. And here's what I want you to do. I want to take just a couple moments. Turn to a person either next to you or the person whose face you may not recognize and say good morning, happy Sabbath. I'm so happy you're here. Thank you.
Happy Sabbath, each one today. Hope everybody's feeling blessed this morning to be here in the house of the Lord on the Lord's Day, the Sabbath. Has anybody felt this week that, and things have happened, and you, have you ever catch yourself going, Lord, why does this have to happen to me today? Everything's going good when I woke up. I walk out the door and whatever, things happen. Why does this happen to me today? I'm feeling good today. Well, we got to trust in the Lord that He handles anything that comes our way, don't we? He's our sustainer, isn't He? This is the time we go to the Lord in prayer. And we have a short list today. However, I'm sure, again, that we could fill this up front and back and probably a few more sheets as well. But one on the day is David and Betty Lawson, friends of Ima, who's having some health issues. I'd like you to keep that in prayer as well. And Ivani Allen asked us, is her brother, is in the hospital and looks to be an open heart surgery taking place there. So definitely want to keep that in prayer that the doctor's hands, the Lord, the God in it, that everything works out in that area. Is there any unspoken prayers today? Sure, we all have those for sure. Again, this is the time we have our garden of prayer here. If you'd like to come up, you have a burden on your heart, you can do so. Or if you'd like to just sit right where you are and kneel as we go to the Lord in prayer. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, today we thank you for waking us up. Lord, forgiving us, giving us another day of life that we could get in our automobiles and we could come to church and we could lift up you in praise and song, thanking you, Lord, for the mercy that you give upon each one of us each day. Lord, as we are thinking about the ones on our prayer list, we know there's many more. Such as, Lord, as we are thinking about Sandy at home and that her and Mitch and the truly love to be here and those also there as watching as well. We thank you for the opportunity. Nothing like being here, Lord, but still there's Zoom that they each one can be a part of our service and feel blessed by doing so. Lord, we just thank you for our school, that we do have it, that those can come and bring your children, Lord, and can learn about you as they going through life and growing. We ask, Lord, that you be with our school, be with our children. Lord, that the Word of God is highly esteemed and brought out in the children's lives, that they can see through the Word, Lord, who they are and what their needs to be and what God wants them to be in their life. Lord, today as we are here, ready to hear the word, the bread of life, upon the pastor's lips. May his words be your words today. Lord, lift us up in those words that we can carry on our day, this Sabbath day, and through this coming week. Lord, there's terrible things going around our world, and there's things going on in our communities. Lord, help us to, as we have given out, as Tracy given out the papers that we have wrote names on. Help us, Lord, to pray for those names that we have and let them know that we are praying and them also on their name as well. Lord, that we can come together as a church. We can be strengthened by each other's prayers. Lord, we pray for our Wednesday night prayer meeting. Lord, we're all struggling our life each day through the things that we do, and Satan wants us to be busy. But Lord, help our church to be filled up on Wednesday evening through the midweek, that we can take a breath because you are in our lives. Be with us today again, Lord, as we worship you. Lord, let us this day choose whom we will serve, and let it be you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
We're going to ask if everybody can stand, please, as we get ready to sing our opening song, which is Stand Up for Jesus. So join me as we sing.
Sabbath, church. Today's offering is for the local church budget. Have any of you ever been given a gift that was not meant for you? Just a show of hands, any time that ever happened? Well, just a few. I saw a few. Some years ago, my wife invited some people over to our house for my birthday. And it was nothing, you know, special, maybe, you know, really exciting or anything. I don't even remember. It was probably 5 years ago. I don't know. Anyway, some friends came over, and they brought some gifts because they thought it was Mikey's birthday. So I was a recipient of 3 Hot Wheels for my 40-something's birthday, which I was excited about, but I couldn't really say much because, you know, even though they were brand new, they really weren't going to work for me. So, yeah, 3 new brand new cars, not so exciting. So we have a situation that in Leviticus 17 where God was telling the Israelites that when they bring their offerings to him, they need to do it a certain way so that there's no mistake who the gift is for. They're making sacrifices outside the camp in different areas and outside in a way that was not what God was wanting. And Leviticus 17 verse 5 says, "This is so the Israelites will bring their sacrifices they are now making in the open fields. They must bring them in. They must bring them to the priest, that is, to the Lord, at the entrance to the tent of meeting and sacrifice them as fellowship offerings." What was happening was they were doing things, they're presenting sacrifices as if those that do that sacrifice to idols. We bring our regular offerings and tithe to church because it is part of true worship. Leviticus 17:5 gives instruction about the appropriate place to offer sacrifice in ancient Israel. There is a central place to give with no provision for alternatives. One may legitimately ask why the place was so significant. Interestingly, the text focuses not only on the place, the tent of meeting, but also the one who received their sacrifices, the Lord. For the Israelites, the tent of meeting was a tabernacle of the Lord, the place where the Lord resides. Ultimately, the restriction about the place had to do with who they were worshiping. Relocating the place where they brought their sacrifices was typical of idol worship at the time. God designated one place for sacrifice because he wanted to be the sole object of their true worship. Today, the appropriate designation for tithe and offerings remains a frequently asked question and debated as well. The example of King David provides us with an answer. "I will come to your temple with burnt offerings and fulfill my vows to you." That's Psalm 66:13. Ellen White applies this principle to God's people today. The time has come when the tithes and offerings belonging to the Lord are to be used in accomplishing a decided work. They are to be brought to the treasury to be used in an orderly way to sustain the gospel labors in their work. That's Manuscript Release, Volume 19, 376, page 376. She specifies that place as the church treasury with the appropriate agency to support God's mission. However, this does not remove our social responsibility towards the poor and needy. We should apportion special donations for this purpose. And that's in Welfare Ministry, page 275. Now, I just want to take a moment and make sure everyone understands what the difference between tithe and offering. When we give tithe, which is returning a tenth of our increase to the Lord, those funds go straight to the conference. Not a single penny stays in this building or is in support of this local ministry. The funds that are taken, sent to tithe, essentially are paying for those that work for the Lord. Now, Pastor Ralph, he is paid by the conference. His salary is from that tithe. And our church, in a way, because we are large, we are supporting other ministers in other churches that may not be very large and they may not have the means to provide for the salary that a pastor may need to provide for himself and his family. So in a way, we as a church in our tithes are supporting pastors in other areas and other districts in this conference because we are here and we are blessed. But our offering stays here. Our church budget specifically stays here. It supports this church. It supports the ministries that we have here. It allows us to outreach to the community and do things that we are doing so much of. And it's important to understand that that is a great and important work. And I don't want to spend too much time, but I just want you to take a moment to look at your bulletin. In the middle section, it talks about, it shows what where we are at financially. Just be aware that our ministry continues to move forward. And sometimes our needs need to line up with those ministries. And so I want you to be aware that we continue to move forward in faith, and we ask the Lord to bless us as we go forward. But I just want you to understand that this church is an important church for this community. And it would be, I've heard people say, the Lord doesn't need our money. Well, I agree. The Lord would do his work without the funds that we could provide. The Lord doesn't need this church either, but that would be a disappointment, I'm afraid. So just remember that we have a work here to do. So I just want to remind you all that there is a difference between tithe and offerings. So this week, as we think about what we can give to the Lord, I just pray that you would remember the work that we have individually to do, what we can do from the blessings that the Lord gives us. And before I pray, I want you to remember also that our offertory is going to be by a Better Covenant, and they will be presenting a concert tonight at 6 p.m. So I want you to hear the sample of what their message to be that will be to us in music just now, and then come later tonight at 6 to hear more. Lord, I want to pray now and ask the Lord for his blessing upon us. Lord, thank you so much for blessing us and providing for us. We are thankful. You provide so much for us in ways that we can never count. Lord, I just think about this church, and we have a work to do, and we all have a part to play in providing for those needs so we can share that message, share that mission with the local community. So I pray that you would bless the offering that is collected today. And I just pray that you would continue to help this church to grow and thrive and to see your blessing upon us all. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Beneath that flood, lose all their guilty
It is now time for the children's story, and Jennifer's getting ready for that.
Sorry.
So have the little children, some of them are big too, go back to the back, grab a basket, and come forward, and we'll collect the lamb's offering.
Good morning. How are you guys this morning? All right. Did you know that the word heart is used over 700 times in the Bible? So when the Bible uses the word heart, it's usually talking about who we really are on the inside, like how we think and feel and what we choose. And this is what the Bible tells us about our heart. It says, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. So the Bible says that there's a huge problem with our hearts, right? Sorry, it's hard to hold the microphone and do this at the same time. Okay, for those of you that can read, no, just hold this. No, I'm okay now. I'm good now. All right, so God calls this problem what? Can anybody read that? Sin, that's right. Okay, so God is the perfect king who created the universe, and sin is anything you think, say, or do that breaks his perfect rules. You do things like lying and cheating and fighting and wanting your own way because you were born with a heart that wants to sin. And even if you try to be really, really good, you will still sin because you have a sinful heart. And you can't fix it or change it by yourself. The worst part is a sinful heart will keep you away from God forever because he is so perfect that sin can never stay close to him. All sin deserves the punishment of death and separation from God's wonderful love and awesomeness. But thousands of years before you were born, God planned for a way for you to have a new heart so you could enjoy being with him forever. Can you hold that for me? Hold it up to me so I can talk. Okay.
The Bible says, a new heart will I also give you. And God did this by sending his perfect son, Jesus, to save people from sin. And Jesus did millions of good and wonderful things while he was here. But he never thought, said, or did anything wrong. His heart was perfect and pure and totally sinless. And that's the kind of heart you need in order to be close to God. Jesus can forgive your sins and give you a new heart too. So Jesus never sinned, but he chose to take the punishment of your sin by being nailed to a what? What is that? A cross. That's right. Thank you. All right. So he bled and died on that cross, and while Jesus was dying on the cross, God took your sin and the sin of the whole world and put it on Jesus. So now he had all of our sin on him. Now, when God looked at the heart of Jesus, he saw horrible sin. And the Bible says, for he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. And God put your sin and my sin on Jesus and punished him for it instead of us. And Jesus died and was separated from God in our place. But he didn't stay dead, did he? God brought Jesus back to life, and he made him the awesome king of heaven and earth. And because of what Jesus did, God can save you from sin by giving you a new heart that's ready to be with him forever. And when you believe Jesus is really God's perfect son who died and came back to life to take the punishment for your sin, then God says you will be saved from sin. And he takes that perfectness of Jesus and puts it on your heart so that when he looks at you and he'll see the perfect heart of Jesus instead of your sin. And your heart is made new, and having a new heart makes you ready to live with God forever in heaven someday. And it also makes you ready to love and enjoy God right now, but only Jesus can give us that new heart. So let's pray and ask him to do that right now. Can you close your eyes? All right. Dear Jesus, thank you for dying for each of our sins, and thank you so much for loving us like that. We ask that you give us new hearts today, and we ask all this in your name. Amen. Thank you for listening. You guys can go back to your seats.
Happy Sabbath. Our scripture reading for today will be found in Jeremiah 17, verses 9 through 10. And it says, "The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? I, the Lord, search the heart. I test the mind, even to give every man according to his ways, according to the fruit of his doings."
So don't do that to me, Brian. Okay. Thought he was starting to play with me or something back there. My mic's not on. I pushed it the wrong way. How about now? No. I went the right way the first time. No. How about a dead battery? Oh, hey. I hear it. Can you hear me now? Okay, good. All right, that was a good start, wasn't it? All right, so now that we've got the bugs worked out, this morning, as you can see, that our topic is the Lucifer effect. And we're going to be looking at, really, what's happened in our world, all because of one decision that Lucifer made at the very beginning. And this morning, I'm hoping that you will start to get a picture of the real battle that we are in. Now, we talk about these things all the time, and I want you to know that more and more, I have become more burdened with helping other people and myself to realize that the real battle is right here. Do you agree with that? The real battle is right here, and I want to say something very clear to you this morning. I want you to understand that the mark of the beast is nowhere near as dangerous as the beast that's in your heart. And this morning, my prayer is that as we go through this topic, that again, that our hearts will be broken at the foot of the cross, that we will recognize how desperately we need Jesus and the power of His strength and His grace. And I want to invite you to just pray with me and for me this morning as we begin. Let's bow our heads. Loving Father in heaven, as I've been praying all week, Lord, as I pray every week for this church family, and for the work that we are wanting and longing to do in our community, Lord, we want to be a blessing to this community, but we know that the devil is on the warpath. And we know that he is doing all that he can because we are claiming to be one of those churches that presents the last warning message to the world, the three angels' messages. Lord, help us to understand that that is what's turned up the heat even hotter on God's people. And the closer that we get to time, things will not get easier, they will get harder. And we need to understand this morning that it is only by your grace, only by your strength, that we will be able to stand through these times and be able to look up with joy and say, lo, this is our God. We have waited for him, and he will save us. Father, this morning I'm praying for the outpouring of your Holy Spirit. We've come into your house. This place is holy ground. And we have come this morning. We have come asking that you would reveal your presence to us through your Spirit. Every one of us, Lord, has had a different week. Some have had a pretty good week, and some have had some tremendous struggles. But I pray that we will open our hearts now, let your Spirit come in, and that you would take us to the very throne of heaven this morning. Fill us with your Spirit. Move mightily among your people. And I pray, Lord, that you would push me out of the way. Let your people see Jesus this morning. Let them hear his voice and his words. Without you, I can do nothing. And so I pray for the power of your Spirit to be in me as well. So move upon us now. Lead us and show us what you want us to know for our own good, that we may be the people you've called us to be. In Jesus' name, amen. I had a friend that I was talking to a few weeks ago, and they said that they're really concerned because they feel like that their church is under attack. They feel like the devil is just trying to do everything that he can to destroy their church and to rip their church apart. I've been pastoring for 23 years now, and I believe that the devil has never stopped with that goal in mind. Every church that I've ever been to has always had times and places where it was very evident that the devil was trying to shred that church and rip it apart so it would be of no effect to the community around it. So this morning, I just want all of us to be thinking about our own church right here. That God is wanting to use us, but in order to be able to be used, we, every single one individually, need to be surrendered and submitted fully to Him. This morning, you need to understand salvation is an individual issue. I cannot save you, and you cannot save me. It is only by my relationship with Jesus Christ that I will be saved. Heaven is doing all that they can that you and I might have an opportunity to be in that kingdom and spend eternity with Jesus. And I don't know about you, but I'm old enough to know that this world has got nothing to offer me that would make me think I'd rather stay here than to be there with him. So this morning as we begin, well, you know, it's interesting. Talk about sabotage. So this morning I got here, and I thought to myself, you know, I haven't put batteries in this little clicker in a long time. I'll just put a couple of batteries in, and I got here, and I didn't know where any batteries were. And let's just see if it fell asleep or... No, okay. All right, so let's move on. When we look at the scriptures, Jesus and the apostles give us a strong warning about the last days. There are many places where Jesus and the apostles spoke to us about what would take place in the last days. And we often look at those and we say, okay, these are the final events of Earth's history. They are the last events that will take place before Jesus comes. But what is Jesus and the disciples, what are they trying to tell us in those announcements that they make, in those things that they bring up in Scripture? So this morning, we're going to begin. Now, by the way, this is the reason why I don't often do PowerPoint, and that's because I feel like that all of us get plenty of screen time. And I would love it if every one of us had a Bible. And I understand that sometimes you bring your phone or your iPad or different things, but I want to encourage you to just start bringing a Bible to church, because sometimes it's just nice to open the book. It's just nice to have a Bible in your hands. And so we're going to look real quickly here. These are going to be three passages we're going to look at as we begin this morning. Three passages. This first one is Matthew chapter 24. Matthew chapter 24. And we're going to be looking at verses 42 to 44. Matthew 24, verses 42 to 44. Now, Jesus said, "Watch therefore, for ye know not what hour your Lord doth come. But know this, that if the good man of the house had known in what watch the thief would come, he would have watched and would not have suffered his house to be broken up. Therefore, be ye also ready, for in such an hour as ye think not, the Son of Man cometh." Now, you're all familiar with that text. It's at the end of Matthew chapter 24. Jesus has gone and he has listed a various array of different events that are going to take place before he comes. But what is it that he wants us to understand about the events? He wants us to understand that we need to be watching so that when we see the event, we know that we need to be getting ready, because he is giving us the signal that he is coming soon. So Jesus said several things, but I want you to, if you look at the very beginning of that chapter, he kind of began his response to the disciples with the words of, "Take heed to yourself." Jesus wanted the disciples to understand. You and I need to understand that all of this information is so that we will be armed and equipped to understand where we are in time and what it means to us, and so that we are not taken unawares. So Jesus said, "Take heed." Then he said, "Watch, be ready, because there's a coming crisis." In the book Desire of Ages, it tells us there is a crisis coming that is stealthily sneaking upon us. We need to be watching So that when we see the events that are taking place in the world, our eyes are open. We're not sticking our head in the sand and saying, oh, Jesus is going to take care of me. I love Jesus. Everything's going to be great. No, we're saying, no, I know that all these things are going to be taking place. The other thing that I want you to recognize is that all of the distractions, all of the deceptions that are going on in the world around us are to steal your soul and mine from the kingdom of heaven. Yes, we call them trials, we call them tribulations, but they are deceptions, they are distractions, and they are the enemy doing his work to steal every soul that he can before this whole controversy comes to an end. Go to 2 Timothy chapter 3, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 5. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 5, Paul is also talking about the last days, and Paul paints a different picture. Jesus was talking about the signs that he had given and talking about how we needed to be watching those signs. Paul brings it to a different level. He brings it to a spiritual level, to our own personal spiritual walk, and whether or not we are connected to Jesus. So he begins in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1. This know also that in the last days perilous times shall come. The last days perilous times shall come. Not might or possibly, they shall come. Now, here's how they may come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, truce breakers, false accusers, incontinent or out of control, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying the power thereof, from such turn away. Now, I would like, and I think you probably would like it, if Paul was saying, that's what the world's going to look like you live in. But Paul is saying, no, that's what the church is going to look like that you live in. He's talking about people who are professed followers of Jesus. You see, Paul is starting to make sure that we understand there's a huge difference between being a professed follower of Jesus and a true follower of Jesus. And he brings it out here and he reminds us, he said, the professed follower of Jesus, now you need to hear this, the professed follower of Jesus claims to love Jesus, claims to follow Jesus, but guess what? They have a form of godliness, but deny the power thereof. There is no victory in their life. They are not coming away from the things of the world. In fact, they're comfortable. This is something that you need to remember. And this is one of the reasons why sometimes I don't know if I like living here in America where we are so comfortable. You know, we have a storm come through. We don't like it if the power goes off for 2 days. Think about the people around the world that live with no power. They have no bathrooms. They have no running water. They have none of these things. But we're very, very comfortable where we are. And you know what else we're comfortable with? We have gotten to be comfortable with the world. The Christian church has gotten to a place where sin is no longer sin. We don't look at the sin of the world. We just kind of push it off to the side. We don't say, no, that's got to stop. We can't do that. The church is going to have to be standing up and become a peculiar people once again. God's people are going to have to be standing for the truth. And this is what Paul's trying to get. That in the last days, there will be perilous times. And there is going to be a group of professed followers of Jesus who have a form of godliness. Oh, they've got the churches, they've got the funds, they've got all the money to do all these religious things, but they have no power of God. I don't know about you, but I'd rather worship in a barn and have the power of God than a big, beautiful church. Amen. I want to have the power of God in my life this morning. I want you to go to the last one. This one to me is perhaps the strongest illustration that we have of the kind of warning Jesus has given us. Luke chapter 21. Luke chapter 21, and we're going to begin in verse 25. It's some of the words that Jesus warns us about in these last days yet again. Luke chapter 21, and we're going to begin in verse 25. Now, you're all familiar with a lot of these verses, and we know that a lot of the signs that Jesus talked about, almost all of them, we've already seen happen. That should tell you something right there. If you go through Matthew 24, if you look around at other places in the Bible, and every sign that you're looking at, you've already seen it come and go, then brother and sister, you better be saying, whoa, Jesus is right around the corner. And the last movements are going to be what? Rapid ones. Luke chapter 21, verse 25, check it out. And there shall be signs in the sun and the moon and the stars, and upon the earth distress of nations. We've all known that there were signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars. We've all seen that happen in the 1800s. That stuff has all taken place. So now we're looking at upon the earth distress of nations. Tell me we are not smack dab in the middle of distress of nations. We're in the middle of it. It is all around us with perplexity. Inspiration tells us that there is going to come a point in time, and I believe we're there, where men no longer have the answers to the problems in our world. Do you think we're there? There's no answers. They keep trying to come up with things, but we are at a place where there are no answers. Perplexity. The sea and the waves roaring. We just had another hurricane come through. Men's hearts. Now listen to this. Men's hearts are failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth. When you have no answers, you begin to be afraid of what's going on around you. And we're going to look at that a little bit more. The powers of heaven shall be shaken. Then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. In verse 28, here's your encouragement right now today. When these things begin to happen, when they begin to come to pass, then look up and lift up your heads, for your redemption draweth nigh. Jesus is just around the corner. And if you're holding on to Jesus, when he comes, you're not going to be afraid. You're going to be rejoicing because you see him in the clouds. And then you go down to verse 34 now. This is where he wants you and me to get it. He wants us to get it. He says, take heed to yourselves, lest at any time your hearts be overcharged with surfeiting, excess in eating and drinking, and the cares of this life. So that day come upon you unawares. Now listen, a lot of you I've gotten to know pretty well, and I know my own circumstances, and all I can tell you is this, everybody in this room has the cares of this life. Every single one of us. I could sit down with every one of you and you could tell me something going on in your life right now that's a struggle for you. That you're wondering, okay, when is this going to end? When am I going to get to move to a little more peaceful or a little more happy time? Am I right? You're quiet. Am I right? Of course I'm right. I know, because your life is no different than mine. Don't think that because I'm a pastor, my life is any different than yours. It's not. In fact, I want you to know, my life is worse than yours become a pastor. The devil doesn't let me rest for 1 minute. Because if I'm doing something that he... Now, that's the only thing that gives me encouragement, is if I feel like the devil is on me for some reason, I'm going, well, then I must be doing something okay. I must be doing something okay, because he's not letting up. But I want you to understand that. Jesus wants us to know that it's the cares of this life that are going to drag people away from him, because they think God doesn't care. God's letting all this stuff happen in my life. He doesn't care. He cares more about you than you can imagine or think. He poured out all of heaven. He gave his only begotten Son so that any one of us in this room could choose to be saved. And then he closes it out and he says in verse 36, watch ye therefore and pray always that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass and to stand before the Son of Man. So here it is. What did Jesus say? Take heed. Don't be overcharged with excess of eating and drinking and the cares of this life. Watch and pray and stand. Now, I want you to know something. If you don't trust Jesus right now, if you aren't standing in his strength, then I got some news for you. You're not going to be standing looking up when he comes and going, oh, here comes Jesus. You're going to be standing there, and you're going to be starting to look around, and you're going to say, please get the rocks to fall on me. I don't want to see his face. But I've got good news again for you. And guess what? This verse is not on that screen. Isn't that exciting? It's not on that screen. That means it's free, and I'm going to share it with you this morning free. It's an extra. So we're going to go to Ephesians chapter 6. You got to go there quick, though, because I don't want you telling me I took too long. Ephesians chapter 6 and verses 10 through 13. Jesus' last thought was that you will be able to stand, and I want you to know that Paul gives you the remedy or the cure for being able to stand. Here it is, Ephesians chapter 6, beginning in verse 10. You're going to love this again. Don't ever walk out of here saying, I didn't give you some encouragement, because I'm encouraging you right now. Paul says, finally, my brethren, be strong in who? In the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. Paul tells us how we do it. We're going to be able to stand through all of this and be standing when Jesus comes, when we put on the whole armor of Christ. Here is a statement that is found in pamphlet 89. Page 19, and look at the picture it paints of the Christian. We don't have to do this on our own. What should our Christian life and character be? Since God has given us such wonderful light, illuminating the way to heaven, what constant zeal, what prayerful watchfulness should mark our Christian course? Jesus says, strive to enter in at the straight gate. For many, I say unto you, will seek to enter in and shall not be able. But though the way is so straight, there is no need to despair if we listen to the voice of God. You remember a couple of weeks ago we played that video, Listen to the Voice? Are we listening to God's voice? It says, if we listen to the voice of God and obey him instead of our own unsanctified impulses, Christ has said, my grace is sufficient for thee. His strength is made perfect in weakness. So, distractions, deceptions. What does it all look like? What does our world really look like? If you just sat back and you started looking down through all the different places that the devil has attacked. We just went through a 2.5-year period of a pandemic. COVID-19 and all of its variants came through, and masks and vaccines and the turmoil and the confusion and the division, the anger and the fear that went on through that time. 96 million cases recorded, 1 million deaths. But that's nothing. What about sexual violence and abuse that's been going on for years and is still going on right under our noses and perhaps even in our church? Nearly 1 in 5 women and 1 in 71 men in the United States have been raped at some time in their lives. What about homelessness? Every day, I don't know about you, but if I go anywhere in town, there is a homeless person standing on some corner looking for someone to help. 17 out of every 10,000 people in the United States were experiencing homelessness on a single night in January 2019 during HUD's annual point in time count. Violent crime. After World War II, crime rates increased in the United States, peaking from the 1970s to the early 90s. Violent crime nearly quadrupled between 1960 and its peak in 91. Property crime more than doubled over the same period. You know, I want to add to this violent crime. I don't know about you, but every day if I go to look on MSN.com or some news channel, every single day there is some violent crime that has taken place somewhere in our country. And I mean, they're heinous crimes. Sometimes I can't even picture how people can do the kinds of things, but we're going to find out. Pornography has become a pandemic in itself. Pornography, the following percentages of children. We wonder why so many adults are hung up or hooked up on pornography. Could it be that perhaps they got hit as young children and it's carried right on through? Look at what goes on here. In this 2020 research, 51% of children 11 to 13 years old have been exposed. 66% of 14 to 15 year olds. 79% of 16 to 17 year olds. Pornography is a $97 billion industry, $15 billion alone in the U.S. But then it comes to home. It comes right into the home. What are the two institutions that came out of the Garden even? Sabbath and marriage. And is the devil working on both of those? You believe he's working on both of those, and he's doing a number on both of those. But look what he's doing to marriage, divorce. We know these numbers. The divorce rate, the United States, it's the marriage rate is currently 6.8 per 1,000 population. The divorce rate is 3.2 per 1,000. So it's almost 50% of all marriages in the United States will end in divorce or separation. Researchers estimate 41% of all first marriages end in divorce, 60% of second marriages, and 73% of third marriages. Human trafficking. This is one that is getting more and more exposure in the recent year. Trafficking involves transporting someone into a situation of exploitation. This can include forced labor, marriage, prostitution, and even organ removal. Human trafficking earns global profits of roughly $150 billion a year for the traffickers, $99 billion of which comes from commercial sexual exploitation. You know, if you go to one of these big Super Bowls or football games or any of those huge sporting events, rest assured that there is sexual exploitation going on all over the cities around it. Those are the times when they make their money. Globally, an estimated 71% of enslaved people are women and girls, while men and boys account for 29%. Domestic violence, it's not just out there in the world, it's coming into our homes. On an average of nearly 20 people per minute are physically abused by an intimate partner in the United States. During 1 year, that equates to more than 10 million women and men. These are scary statistics. They're heartbreaking statistics. Right is wrong, and wrong is right. Do you agree with that? Right is wrong, and wrong is right in the country that we live in. And truth to our world is relative. You can have your truth, and I can have mine, but there is no absolute truth according to most, unless, of course, it's my truth and what I believe based on my worldview. We are seeing attempts to make legislation that will drastically change our freedoms and rights as citizens. You know, I've had people talk to me in years past, and they talk about national Sunday laws. They say, how could that ever happen? We have a constitution. Our constitution is being tampered with on a daily basis. And you are starting to begin to understand that lawmakers change the laws as it suits their need. Do you understand that? That's just not me talking. That's what's happening. The attempts of legislation, you may remember this particular, the Equality Act. It was expanding the LGBTQ protection, and it got through and it passed in the House of Congress, but that was in 2021. It is still in the Senate because there's a huge battle going on over this, and Republicans broadly opposed the legislation. They echoed the concerns from religious groups and social conservatives who worry the bill would force people to take actions that contradict their religious beliefs. And all I can tell you this morning is, it's coming. A most recent survey, I believe this was done by Pew Research, 61% of U.S. adults say abortion should be legal, all or most of the time, while 37% say it should be illegal or most of the time. The CDC reported a yearly national total for abortions in 2019. There were 629,890 abortions. I want you to see what another agency came up with. Guttmacher's latest available figures from 2020 showed that there were 930,160 abortions in 2020. I want to go back there because I have a little bit something that I think you'll find very interesting. Roe versus Wade was established in 1973. And after that, the abortion rate peaked in 1980 at 1.6 million abortions that year. 1.6 million unborn babies losing their lives. Now I want you to think of that. Just recently, it's 930,000 abortions. Look at it and compare it to these forgotten diseases that we seem to just have grown to where we're just comfortable living with them. Heart disease cases nearly doubled over the period from 271 million in 1990 to 523 million in 2019. The number of heart disease deaths rose from 12.1 million to 18.6 million in December of 2020. In 2020, an estimated 1,806,000 new cases of cancer were diagnosed, and 606,520 people died from cancer. But really, who's the real enemy? Is the real enemy this morning COVID? Is it government? Is it big pharma? Is it big tech? Is it the media? Is it domestic violence? Is it violent crime? Is it pornography? Is it human trafficking? Is it divorce? What in the world is wrong with our world? Could it be that we are suffering from the Lucifer effect? Are we suffering from the Lucifer effect? An important story. I want you to go to Isaiah chapter 14 quickly. Isaiah chapter 14. Isaiah chapter 14, verses 12 through 14. We're only going to look at this one this morning, but this will give you a picture of what Lucifer brought into our world that we live in today. Isaiah 14, verses 12 through 14. The question is asked, how art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which did weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, remember, I want to thank you for the children's story this morning because this is a heart issue. The battlefield is our hearts. And Lucifer said in his heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. The Lucifer effect. Here's what it brought into our world. Pride, selfishness, envy, jealousy, hatred, ungratefulness, dissatisfaction, evil surmising, no trust, stubbornness, judgmental, hardened hearts into our world. In other words, simply rebellion against a loving God. That's what the Lucifer effect has done for us. Let's look at our scripture for this morning. Jeremiah chapter 17. Jeremiah chapter 17, verses 9 and 10. Jeremiah 17, verses 9 and 10. Abigail read this beautifully for us today, beginning verse 9. And I believe Jennifer actually quoted verse 9. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Now, you know, I've asked you this once before, but I do like this illustration. Have you ever gotten up in front of in the morning when you go to get ready and you look in the mirror and you go, desperately wicked heart. I've got a desperately wicked heart. You ever do that in the mirror? I've never done that. I've never looked at myself in the mirror and said that. But the Bible tells us that the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? If you have not surrendered your heart on the battlefield of the controversy to Jesus, then you have a deceitful and desperately wicked heart. Yes. And God says, I, the Lord, search the heart. I try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways and according to the fruit of his doings. The Lucifer effect is nothing new. We're seeing it as we come down to the end of time. But at the time of the flood, God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth. Now listen, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And Jesus reminded us, but as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. Here's what I want to tell you this morning. The world condition is not our problem. The world condition is not our problem. You can take this one home with you. The condition of our hearts is the problem with our world. The condition of our hearts is the problem with our world. It's the problem in our families. It's the problem in our churches. It's the problem in our lives all around us. It's not the world. Because you know what? We can control how we respond to the world. The issue is all right here. That's what's got to change. It's got to be given to Jesus. The Bible is clear. We are where we are, yes, because of a pandemic, a disease that's prevalent throughout an entire country, continent, or the whole world, but it's not COVID or any other disease, but a pandemic of wicked, rebellious hearts. And you say to yourself, but I don't have a wicked heart, but you may have that one thing that you don't like about someone else. Or you may have that one thing that you hold on to and you think, well, the rest of my life is good. I just have that one thing. Judas walked out into utter darkness because he just had that one thing. We've got to give everything to him. He has to have everything. This pandemic can hit anyone, no matter your position, your biblical knowledge, your place in God's work. How many of you know who Ravi Zacharias is? Not many of you. That's amazing. Ravi Zacharias was a world-renowned apologist. He went all over the world defending the gospel, teaching the gospel, preaching the gospel. All over the world, he was renowned. He had a ministry that was spread in every continent of this world. But Ravi Zacharias had one problem, and that was that he began thinking that he needed something that wasn't his. Ravi Zacharias started building relationships with all these massage therapists and started forcing them to do things beyond what was called for. And he began building up this network to the point that no one else knew what was going on. His poor family and kids had no idea what was happening. But this man had sexually abused many, many women over the course of this ministry. One woman, he said, that God is allowing you and I to do this because he's blessing me for all my work. Listen, the Lucifer effect can hit anyone. And even those who become successful in God's work, he wants to see what he can do to draw you away. It can happen to any of us. We need to be watching and aware. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5, examine yourselves, whether you be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know you not your own selves how that Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be reprobates, a morally depraved, unprincipled, or wicked person. I don't want to be that, do you? I just don't want to be that. I want to pray, Jesus, help me with these little things that I don't think are so big, but I know that they could keep me from the kingdom. Matthew 26, 41, Jesus said, watch and pray that you enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. From Thoughts on Mount of Blessing, you are probably familiar with this. The Christian life is a battle and a march. But the victory to be gained is not won by human power. The field of conflict is the domain of the heart. The battle which we have to fight, the greatest battle that was ever fought by man, is the surrender of self to the will of God, the yielding of the heart to the sovereignty of love. And here's another beautiful quote. We've been talking so much about prayer. Prayer has to become, as we talked about in our revival series, it's got to be the foundation of everything that we do. It all begins with prayer. Look at this quote. Prayer turns aside Satan's attacks. Prayer unites us with one another and with God. Prayer brings Jesus to our side and gives to the fainting, perplexed soul new strength to overcome the world, the flesh, and the devil. Prayer turns aside the attacks of Satan. Amen. Jesus said, watch and pray. Watch and pray. There's only one way this morning that you and I are not going to be overcome by all of the deceptions, all of the distractions that are given to us by the Lucifer effect. It's only by the strength of God's amazing grace. In 2 Corinthians 12 and verse 9, and he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. True life and freedom is not found in all of these things that the world is trying to distract us with. True life and freedom is found in dying to self, that Jesus may live in us. Paul said, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me, in my heart. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Don't be drawn in to the Lucifer effect. Let the strength of God's amazing grace transform you into his image and likeness, a reflection of him to the world. That's what Jesus is looking for. That's what the world is going to need in the middle of all this that we just looked through a few moments ago. And remember this encouraging statement from Christ Object Lessons. When the character of Christ shall be perfectly reproduced in his people, then he will come to claim them as his own. I like this statement, John Newton. If I ever reach heaven, I expect to find three wonders there. First, to meet someone I had not thought to see there. Second, to miss someone I had thought to meet there. And third, the greatest wonder of all, to find myself there. For by grace are you saved through faith. Salvation is a gift. Don't wait any longer. Accept the free gift of Jesus' transforming power in your life today. The answer to the Lucifer effect is the strength of God's grace. Amen. His strength is perfect. Amen. You know, you know how much I love to sing, and this song is one that I just learned. It's a song written by Stephen Curtis Chapman. It's a beautiful song, but it is based off of 2 Corinthians 12 and verse 9, where we're told that my grace is sufficient for you because my strength is made perfect in weakness. So I want you to listen to the words and just ask God to move on your heart as you listen.
I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength, but sometimes I wonder what he can do through me. No great success I show, no glory of my own, yet in my weakness he is there. Our strength is gone. He'll carry us when we can't carry on. Raised in his power, the weak become strong. His strength is perfect. His strength is perfect. know the power that he holds. When we truly see how deep our weakness goes, his strength in us begins. Listen now, when ours comes to an end, he hears our humble cry and proves again. His strength is perfect when our strength is gone. He'll carry us when we can't carry on. Raised in his power, the weak become strong. His strength is perfect. His strength is perfect. His strength is perfect. His strength is perfect.
Let's bow our heads as we close. Heavenly Father, oh, what a mess of a world we live in, Lord, and sometimes it goes beyond just looking out at the news, and it comes into our homes, it comes into our lives. And the devil's trying to use all of these different angles and distractions and problems. He's trying to use all of these things, Lord, to draw us away from you, to make us lose our hope and to give up on what we believe. Lord, I pray this morning that we would recognize that song, Lord, it speaks to my heart. I hope it speaks to all of our hearts, because it says that his strength is perfect when our strength is gone. Lord, when we feel like we have no strength left at all, that's when your strength is perfect. That's when you can do your greatest work in our lives. Oh, help us not to give up. Help us to not stop trusting. Help us to hold on to Jesus, because he's promised he's going to finish this work and take us home. Lord, I just pray for everyone in this room. We all are bogged down from time to time with the cares of this life, but help us to know that the devil's using those cares to push us away from you. Help us to realize that what needs to happen is that the cares of this life, the trials, the burdens, need to drive us closer to you and to look more fully into your eyes and your heart, to know how much you love us and that your strength will get us through these times. So, Lord, please be with us. May that be the theme of our hearts today as we leave, that your strength is perfect when our strength is gone. Thank you for being such a good, loving God. Thank you for your patience with each one of us. And thank you for holding on to us in those times when we are weak. In Jesus' name.